Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea, you led your people from Israel, from slavery into freedom. And remember, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life, and above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit. Renew us, our lives, with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord.
prayers of all who call upon you. By your Spirit, show us the things we ought to do, and give us the grace and power to do them through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. We continue with the readings.
Isaiah chapter 58, verses 1 through 9. Just to clarify for you, everything in this reading, except for the first part of verse 3, is God talking to Isaiah. And knowing this helped me to understand this passage a whole lot better. So here's the Lord speaking. Shout out, do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Well, why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice, says Isaiah. Look, you serve your own interest on your fast day and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose? A day to humble oneself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush? To lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them? And not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, here I am. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, happy.
Second reading is from 1 Corinthians. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or the rulers of this age who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human, except the human spirit that is within? So also no one comprehends what is truly God's except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the gospel application.
Taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Lord.
Well, we are still on that mountain with Jesus. Our gospel reading picks up where we left off last Sunday, right after the Beatitudes. And after all that good news about the meek and the poor and the hungry being lifted up and liberated, and enjoying that freedom that the reign of Christ would bring, Jesus turns to some really practical matters. Salt and light. Two things we probably wouldn't want to live without. It is quite a shift from those loftier matters of giving aid to the destitute, showing mercy, making peace. Suddenly, to use one of Matthew's favorite words, Jesus turns to ordinary things, to that salt we have in our pantries and the light that defines our days. This passage ends with something that can trouble us. How should we be more righteous than the scribes and the Pharisees of all things? When Jesus speaks of peacemakers and the pure and the merciful, we realize that we should be like them, to act as they do. But when Jesus speaks of being more righteous than these groups with reputations for being rule-following hypocrites, we should become a little uneasy. Now, last week I bought a nice little fillet of salmon, and the cashier asked what I was going to do with it. And I said, I will probably make a green curry. And he said that he likes to pan fry his. And I asked him if he had ever cooked his salmon in salt. He hadn't, so I told him that he could take a cast iron pan, put about an inch of salt in the bottom of the skillet, throw the salmon on top, skin side down, and it is the most wonderful cooking technique you ever saw, because you can watch that salmon get a little whiter and take it off when it's still nice and tender and moist. But don't do it in your house, put it on the grill, it smokes a lot. That's just for free this morning. The fish absorbs just enough salt to be perfectly flavored. It's quite miraculous. But you wouldn't believe what you see when you take it off that salt. Underneath where that fish lay is a bunch of dirty, greasy, almost black salt. You've got to throw it out. Salt flavors and it preserves. And I'm sure those fish caught in the Sea of Galilee and sent to Rome were packed in salt to preserve it. But in addition to flavoring and preserving, salt also purifies. We flavor with salt, we preserve in salt, and that choice piece of salmon cooked in the salt is purified by that contact, and the salt gets ruined. Now, we are salt and we are light, and the concern with light is that it be seen, that we let it shine. I have mentioned this before, but I heard a very respected lighting designer for the theater talk about how she lit her stages and the people on them, and she told her students that we always must remember that the light has to fall on something. There has to be an object of that light. You can take your flashlight and shine it into the sky at night, and you will get some dust particles, but that's about it. That light just dissipates. On the other hand, if you take it into your chicken coop when they're squawking at about 3 a.m, and the light lands on 2 beady green eyes, you know you have your possum. So this lesson that Jesus is teaching us is how we are to be in our world. We don't eat salt all by itself, and we don't put a grain basket on top of a candle or some other light that we've just lit. If we do, we've only illuminated the inside of that grain basket. Our salt and our light have to make some sort of contact to do their work. And then there's a curious break in our gospel. Jesus moves from us to him and gives his followers a little lesson about who he is, about his identity as the Son of God. He has come to fulfill the law and the prophets, not to replace them, he tells them. To use a term we apply to salt, Jesus has come to enhance the law and the prophets. We don't throw out a bland soup and then put a bunch of salt in the pot. That doesn't do any good. The two things have to work together. He has come to fulfill the laws, to add his mercy and grace to that tasteless stew that the law had become in Jesus' time. That shift from salt and light to the law is marked by another shift from you to I. Jesus is still teaching his new followers about his identity, but also theirs. You are the light of the world. I have come to fulfill the law. But the emphasis is still on teaching us. Anyone who sets aside even the least of the law's demands gets the lowest place in the kingdom. Anyone who keeps the law and helps others to keep it will rank high in the kingdom. And if we take a step back, we see how that Jesus is creating and describing his kingdom on earth. As children of God, we should embody that salt and light. He tells us why he has come, and then he turns to whoever does, and that whoever happens to be us. The lesson here is one we've heard before. We are back to the doing, the helping, and the teaching others to fulfill the law's demands. And now we have that good advice from the Beatitudes to go beyond rule following and to show mercy, to make peace, to feed and clothe the destitute. The mercy and grace of Christ's new kingdom flavor that bland soup of obedience with the salvation, the mercy, the grace that Jesus gives to us with our participation. The passage of Scripture uses salt and light to teach us how we should live our calling in Christ. Jesus tells us what he has come to do and how we should respond to the love and the mercy he brings to us. And it all seems reasonable until that surprise ending. Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whew. John the Baptist called the Sadducees and the Pharisees a brood of vipers, a generation of snakes. But this is Jesus' first mention of them in Matthew's gospel. Of course, he knew them by reputation, as we do. And he knew that they were very devout. They were known for a very strict, rigid observance of the law, so much so that many had effectively withdrawn from their society. The word Pharisee actually means separated. They separated themselves from the life of the temple and emphasized the possibility for worship outside it. And that is all well and good, but those who withdrew from the world and those who withdraw from the world, like our monastics still do, know that we withdraw from the world in order to come back to rejoin it recharged. We don't stay there. Paul wrote that we cannot separate ourselves from the love of God, and Jesus keeps on telling us that we need each other. The Pharisees' salt had lost its flavor. They were like that grayish ooze under my beautifully cooked salmon that had to be thrown out. Their light was hidden under that grain basket so that no one could really see it. Jesus didn't expect the disciples to outdo these fanatics in their observance of the law. He wanted them to engage, not to withdraw. He wanted them to share their saltiness with the world, not only with each other. He wanted their light to shine on all peoples. It was never meant to be a treasure we guard for ourselves. It must have been quite a lesson for the disciples, who probably expected an easier ride on the road to righteousness. The law taught that they were a chosen people, and they quickly learned to rely on that promise. With worship that was lukewarm and repentance every time a crisis arose, I was always puzzled by those instructions on the bottle of shampoo that, you know, is in the bathroom. It says, rinse and repeat. Why repeat? Didn't it work the first time? I know they want us to buy more shampoo, that's clear, but this isn't exactly a ringing endorsement of the product. Rinse and repeat, Israel's practice of faith for centuries, would not be the way of Jesus' kingdom. His salvation would bring us to truth and light, to an active practice of the faith. And when we put these two halves of our reading together, we can understand that last puzzling, frightening line. The righteousness of God's people has to be shared. Jesus' grace and mercy enhanced the law like the salt enhances our food. In his new kingdom, the law would be illuminated by a pervasive light, his love reflected through us. The key here isn't righteousness, it is community. God wants us to be a little salty, a little assertive, to add some zest. We won't succeed in outdoing scribes and Pharisees by separating ourselves just to look like we're more worthy than our neighbors. The fact that Jesus had come to earth gives us the best evidence that that old system was broken and needed to be fulfilled or completed, as Jesus put it. His message is beginning to sound familiar by now, that anyone who acts, who keeps the law, and urges others to do the same in their proclamation of the risen Christ, will be called great in that kingdom, doing and proclaiming. That is how Jesus got his start, after all, healing and teaching, liberating those who suffered, and preaching the arrival of his new kingdom to all peoples. Our challenge is to keep ourselves a little salty, to burn a little more brightly. Like salt, we may be small in quantity, but great indeed. We are the light of the world, but our light is only effective when we let the love of God shine on us and through us and reflect that light for all around us to see. In a time when our culture opts for a feel-good faith, I believe in a higher power. I don't like church, but I think I'm a good person. We struggle with those who can't see the need for the community of Christ, whose worship has no focus, whose engagement with faith practice is far from active. They want the rewards without doing the work that living in community requires. You might well be a good person, but Jesus' message is about doing and sharing those qualities that God has shared with us. Later, Jesus and we will talk about the fruits we produce as Christians. And I'm reminded that fruits require both the salt of the earth and the light from above to flourish and grow. When we use our salt and light, when we share our zest and our light with our neighbors, we find our place in God's new kingdom. When we let our salt and light work together to produce that fruit. Amen.
Amen.
Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Call your people to seek your wisdom in difficult conversations and action. Give the church everywhere courage to repent for the ways we have tolerated and practiced injustice. Merciful God,
hear our prayer.
Inspire our wonder at creation. From the light of dawn to the beauty of the dark night, sustain the unseen depths of the ocean to the plants and animals we know well. Bring healing to the lands and communities experiencing natural disasters. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Instruct the powerful in your ways. Provide upright leadership in business and industry, that workers are not oppressed. Throughout the world, inspire voters and raise up politicians to heed your call for nations to practice righteousness. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Loosen the bonds of injustice in our midst. Grant peace to endless quarrels. Put an end to hunger and break every yoke of oppression. Shelter all who flee abuse in their homes or violence in their communities. Satisfy those afflicted in any way, especially Lana and Cindy. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Shape our congregation to be salt for the earth. Give us delight in your commandments, that we may be generous with those in need. Make us steadfast in our trust in you, ready with tangible mercy and compassion for our neighbors. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
The cross and resurrection bring redemption from sin and death. We praise you for all whose unshaken faith in Christ shines forth in their witness. Keep them in our remembrance and bring us with them into the kingdom of heaven. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We bring to you our needs and our hopes, O God, trusting in your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Thank you.
us pray. Liberating God, you break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Receive these offerings in thanksgiving for all your works of merciful power, and shape us as people of your justice and freedom. You we magnify and adore, through Jesus our Savior.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. The gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and at this end of all the ages, the gift of your Son, who proclaimed the good news in word and deed and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord took bread, gave thanks, and gave it for all to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." That same night after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup, we remember the life our Lord offered for us, and believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised feast.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, that we who share in Christ's body and blood may live in the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints in light.
Amen. Come, Holy Spirit.
Join our prayers with those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
using the words the Lord taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Come and taste the joy of God. You may be seated. of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Holy One, we thank you for the healing that springs forth abundantly from this table. Renew our strength to do justice, love kindness, and journey humbly with you.
Amen.
The God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod, bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always.
Amen.
Way of Jesus.
Thanks be to God.